That's the cool thing about Urbana-Champaign is the whole idea of bands and the whole idea of an identity. And like, I remember seeing a Dirty Feathers show at a house. It was just the nastiest. Oh, amazing. Like you can't pretend that. Just like the groove was so saggy and like, yo, it was so killing.
This is Champaign is Also a Band podcast. One songwriter, one song. I'm Sven, your host for a journey into the music of Champaign Urbana. Recorded in the Blue Box studio with a songwriter from the Champaign Urbana music scene, past or present. Champaign is Also a Band podcast is proud to be a part of the Champaign Showers podcast network. Welcome to Champaign is Also a Band podcast. Today, I have Reginald Chapman, who you may know from such bands as UTV Chamber, Trio of Justice, No BS Brass, Foxygen, Pressure Fit, Lucky Chops, and you may also remember him performing in such bands as Rebecca Rigo and The Trainmen, and playing with and recording with Elsinore, as well as Church Booty, which is now referred to as Fay Wray. Reginald, welcome to the show.
Hey, thanks for having me.
Today, we'll be listening to your song, Hoodie, from the album Prototype. And so, without further ado, here's the song.
Thank you.
I guess since this is an instrumental piece, my usual favorite question to ask, which is what came first, the lyrics or the music, is probably kind of moot. So
yeah, there's no lyrics.
So
I mean, there were kind of some lyrics, but it was more just like a feeling, you know what I mean? It came out on this album, No BS album, and self-titled in like 2008. So that's a long time ago. It like built this way up into being like, you know, I guess famous, and to the point where like I got a placement on the TV show Empire. The placement was nice, you know. Yeah. It's really cool.
So it was that version that was on?
No,
or the one
that
from
version.
Proto-
that was the that was, that oh, was okay. from the prototype version. I wrote it, and to be honest, I think it was UTV Chamber was a band that I started a long time ago. And we put an album out, and I think it's like on the dark web somewhere. It's like buried. You have to do some web archaeology. There was a period of my life very similar to this period of everyone's life where I was just not really going anywhere. I was just in the house and just kind of going through like one of those like quarter life crisis like we all do, you know, or some of us do, and trying to figure this stuff out. You know, my parents had cut me off because I decided not to go to school. They're like, all right, well, if you're not going to go to school, then you're just going to have to figure this thing out. I was just like making music with my friends and not really making much income in Richmond, Virginia. It was kind of one of those like bittersweet songs, kind of on the precipice of like, what if this thing goes terrible and I just like completely botch this whole life thing, slash there's still hope and let me do something, you know what I mean? It's just kind of one of those like montage songs of young fighting hope.
Yeah, well, that's interesting. So why the title Hoodie? I mean, maybe let's go to like the easiest part.
Oh no, it's so funny because I think some people thought that I named it Hoodie. This was before all the like Trayvon Martin and all that stuff, you know what I mean? So this has there was nothing political about it in a really roundabout way. You know, I happen to be an African-American male and I happen to like to wear hoodies.
Yeah.
And then, you know what I mean? But to be honest, I really love hoodies. And I think it was one of those things where I was like, what should we call it? It's like, what do you really like? I was like, man, I really like hoodies. We should call it Hoodie. Yeah, it's nothing deep about that, to be honest.
I often wonder, what is the thinking behind, you know, giving a title to something that is instrumental? Like, did you title it that before you started writing it, or it was after you had written it?
Oh, yeah, it's so funny. Man, a lot of the songs that I've ever written, the name usually comes afterwards. Like this, I wrote the song Cinnamon Girl. Turns out to be a famous song by someone else.
Oh.
Which is probably terrible for BMI stuff, you know what I mean?
Like, right.
It was actually called, I'm not going to curse on this one just because I have a lot of young fans, but it was called Cinnamon Bee.
Uh-huh.
And I didn't name it that, though. Someone else named it. We were playing it in this brass band, Yo Mama's Brass Band, and someone else named it that. And I was just like young and like, all right, sure. All right, let's call it that. I don't really care. It's a cool song as long as we play our song.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? These days I'm writing stuff and everything's just more intentional. You know, not to say it's not coming out of my experiences, but these days I'm like really squeezing the well dry as far as coming up with materials and stuff. And so sometimes I will name a song like in its earlier stages. I don't know. There's that connection between that sort of analytical brain, your verbal mind, and then just your feelings. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I have a hard time, you know, I have a friend who wanted to like come up with a sort of prompt to write towards. And like, if I'm not feeling that prompt naturally, if that's not just what's pouring out of me, I don't really care.
Yeah. Yeah, well,
and so it's all about the emotion of the song and all of that stuff and whatever, like the shapes and colors and all of that stuff. And then the name of the song was just later.
Yeah, I find it interesting. I feel like jazz, it's the perfect blend of like emotional and analytical all at once. I'm curious for you, what started this song? Do you usually just have like a melody, or does it usually come out when you're playing on your instrument?
This one was a keyboard song. Like I have what they call composer's chops or arranger's chops, to where I can play enough to arrange some things. You know, maybe I have performed on keyboard, but not really. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's just the small, minimal parts. We had this really great acoustic wall piano in the house during that time. And, you know, it was just play all the time, like trying new stuff, new shapes.
Yeah.
And some, you know, it's always like a mixture of theory ideas that you're trying out, plus like what's happening naturally. And you have to like really toe the line. And I didn't have a formal jazz education back then. I was studying classical music on bass trombone. And so, you know, for instance, that line's like, bon, gang, gong, gong, gang. That was me just like kind of trying to imitate some like 2-5, like natural, like jazz 2-5-1 language. But I totally botched it. Like, it's like usually that's not how I'm trying to think about how it goes, but it resolves. It sounds like a 3-6-2-5. But instead of 3-6-2-5-1, it goes 3-6-2-5 and then up a half step and it resolves, which is kind of dope. Like, I didn't know what I was doing. It's actually dope. It sounds killing. It was just me trying to make some stuff, like use what I have, you know?
It's interesting because I do feel like this, although it's brass heavy, but it also does have that kind of keyboard vamping kind of sound to it. Kind of going along. This whole song feels like it's kind of these long broad chords, and then you kind of compress it with these very quick little melodies that are part of the theme that you come up with, and it's this back and forth. It's this wonderful like theme and variation that is going on there, with you have your melody line that starts off with it and then it just seems like it expands. But I don't know, I it's sad because I was just thinking, I'm like, geez, how long has it been since I've looked at like jazz theory, and how am I going to talk about this in a way that's going to,
I don't know, man. I finished the doctoral degree in Urbana-Champaign, and it was great. And I wrote this, like, all of my, I hate to say it, but the most popular music I wrote was stuff that I wrote before all of that. I'm not saying that the degree didn't help me, because it has, and it's helped me with my arranging chops and like all of these things. And like, I enjoy music, and I'm able to do the work and be versatile. The hope with this one is not about someone who is qualified to listen to it. You know what I mean?
Oh yeah.
My hope is it's someone who just likes music and can, you know, and it happens to be. And so like, that was the whole thing. Like the guy who mixed it, this guy, Devon Harris, I just remember when he sat me down, and I appreciate this guy, and I look up to him musically. He was like, yo, this is like some Gil Evans meets Jay Dilla vibes. You know what I mean? Like you have all of this open, amazing arranging, and you know, these blossoming sections and everything that have the, you know, lots of major 7 sharp 11 chords, all this stuff, but still regular people can just like groove with it. So that's the whole goal. The trick is, how can you use that complexity for texture but still make it approachable? In my opinion, a lot of the art that we love and know that like appeals to the masses has that. There's an entry level, and then it just keeps going, and then the more you know, the deeper your knowledge is, the more you like it scratches all the itches, you know. Yeah. And that's my hope, is I can make it the brainiest whatever critic can be like, oh man, he was doing a blah blah blah.
Oh right.
And then they're like, but the person on the street, some like 16-year-old kid, doesn't care about jazz, but like, you know, maybe likes brass instruments or likes like beats or something, can also listen to it and be like, yo, this is dope, I like this, I don't know what's going on with all this other stuff, but like I can still sing it, and I'm still digging it. It's still part of like a tapestry of my life, you know?
I noticed that also Devon Harris also did the keys on this as well. I don't know if it was on this piece specifically, or?
Yeah. Okay. He's playing keys on all this stuff. Yeah.
Okay. Where do you feel like this song draws inspiration, or if you were to make a reference to another piece of music, what would you equate this with?
Yo, that's heavy. I mean, you know, it's so funny. A lot of people have been noticing the whole album has like soul gospel undertones, even though the last, was it Jebish, is like straight up like some Ken Vandermark type vibe. That's a really tough question, man. I don't really know.
It seems to draw upon some of those very strong gospel R&B traditions, but also kind of has, you know, blues and rock, some of that sensibility in terms of just your rhythm section at the end of the song, where there's that kind of drive at the end. I mean, what the bass guitar is doing almost makes me think like it's going to break into a rock song a little bit.
That reminds me, I forgot to put on my list, I toured with the Mountain Goats as well. Growing up in 2004, like early college stuff, I used to listen to a lot of indie rock music for sure, like a lot of Death Cab and a lot of stuff adjacent to that. And maybe some of those sensibilities are in there. I think the difference is there's still like the major 7 sharp 11 chords. That's not really like their vibe, you know, but like having these sort of singable melodies in the sort of like emotional space in that way, in my mind, that's how I hear all those guys, like the Flaming Lips. Yeah, you know what I mean? Yoshimi. I actually have another song that's like very, but yeah, that one uses some of that like harmony, which is like really bright harmony, and like taking the melody and it, like it's a singable melody over this moving harmony, is grabbing some of the upper extensions. And now that I'm thinking about it, maybe some Flaming Lips might be in there as far as the harmony goes, you know? I could see that.
The thing that I noticed on a few of the songs is that you actually have a snare on the 2 and 4, which you don't usually hear that typically in traditional jazz, you know?
I guess the question is this a jazz song, though?
Right. Okay, fair enough.
You know what I mean? To me, it's more of like a funk song. Maybe like a Parliament Funkadelic type, you know?
Yeah.
You know, this is more like a sort of 70s, like, like if you check out something like Herbie Hancock from the 70s, especially mid to late 70s. I was just listening to Roy Ayers recently. Like, it's kind of in that, especially the guys that I recorded with, like, you know, they're really steeped in that type of vibe. And then, I don't know, like, that's a really good question. I think that you know, the whole thing about funk is it's like slowed down and sped up at the same time, to where you have 1, 2, 3, 4. And jazz, I mean, jazz can be slow. Like, you still have 1, 2, 3, 4. You know what I mean? Still, and if it's faster,
right.
You know, it's fast. 1, 2, 3, 4. So I still believe 2 and 4 are really important in jazz as well. But this, like, funk is, you know, being a derivation of jazz, everything is slowed down. So, but then you have, like, inside of that, because of that, you get to double up a little bit on the inside too. It's almost like a drum and bass groove where, like, there's like a whooping pop feel, but inside you have, like, you know, those doubled up drum samples, you know?
Yeah.
So, you know, you still have the on the inside of there, there's still another, like, sub world of 1, 2, 3, 4, right? I don't know. I would say, I think that's the question. That's the real question. Like, I think people hear, and I like that. That's my whole thing, is like trying to, like, find ways to, like, use all of the stuff that I've been, that's been given to me, but make people, trick people into, like, you know what I mean? Like, what is this?
Yeah. So in terms of an arranger or composer, how did you bring this to, can I refer to them as the band, your instrumentalists, the people that played on this record? If I refer to them as the band, is that all right? Just like, is that a fair thing to
say? So the prototype band.
How did you bring this piece specifically to them to kind of flesh it out and make it into the song that it is today?
Man, so it's so funny. This whole album, this was all arranged. Everything was arranged in Sibelius. I brought them a score and parts.
Okay.
They're just that good.
All right.
So I, you know, we did each song, we did maybe 2 or 3 takes tops. Every song you're hearing is a full take. No mixing and matching.
Okay.
Maybe to a click. I'm not sure if we played all of them to a click, actually. The album is multi-tracked. So I did the rhythm section first. So bass, drums, piano. I think playing Rhodes the whole time. Except for Mysterious Hope of Glory, I recorded all the horns at my place, multi-tracked, with just different people in a very unorthodox fashion. First, we put electronic drums over it, but it just, like, wasn't, like, doing fake Logic drums, like a drummer program, and it just didn't sound good. So I got Devon to just track drums underneath, over top, I don't know. And that one actually started out with the bass just by itself, and then I recorded all the horns to the bass track. The thing about it is, at the time specifically, like, that was my community, you know, those were my homies. We had been through so much together over the years. I didn't know Corey Fonville quite as much, but he's from around there, and, like, he knew all the other cats. And so he brought me in, you know, right off the get. Like, he was just like, yo, what's up? You know, he's getting off touring with Christian Scott and all these famous people. Then he comes and hangs out, and like, he's always made me feel like one of the homies, which is awesome, you know. And they had played a lot of the stuff before, because we played gigs before, so it was really easy to just make it happen, you know.
These are all folks that you're used to, like, playing with, and you've had a long history with, for the most part.
Yeah, just about everybody. I mean, that's why I got these people. You know, you kind of pick all the people that you can hear in the part. You know, the horn players are bone players from No BS Brass, and, you know, one of the guys, Carl Leiden, I played with him in the Disney band for a summer. Ben Ford, I had been at graduate school with him. He's playing lead on the whole thing. He is currently in the Navy Commodores right now.
I try to think of, at least with, like, an arranger, and if you have the ability to pick out the particular people that will perform this and play it out, I almost feel like when you pick a certain player and the instrument that they use, because all instruments, whether they're made consistently, all have their own particular tone and sound, and I almost,
and everyone has their own tone as
well. Well, that's what I was
especially
thinking.
On trombone, that's a, you know,
I almost think of, like, as you pick those out, it's like you've kind of already kind of picked the color to a certain extent with what you've written, but it's like you're picking the paintbrush with them when you're painting the picture. And so, like, how do you think about what, like, from an arranging standpoint or even just a writing standpoint, like, oh yeah, I want you to be doing this tessitura of your range, or do you even do that, or is it just like,
oh, absolutely,
everybody kind of hops,
Yo, that's it, man. Look, I mean, a lot of this stuff, it's so funny because I have this stuff on sale on my website.
Mm-hmm.
And man, some of it's, I mean, Ben Ford is just the nastiest lead player alive. Like, just straight up. Number one. I just know him. And so over the years, I've been writing for him for a while, even before then. And so I would just bring him stuff that was like a little too high for him. And he's funny because he's like the biggest heart. When he gets like frustrated, he's like kind of like curmudgeon-y, but really he's like, you know, he's kind of playing around. So like I bring him stuff and he'd be like, oh, and then I'm like, all right, man, I guess I'll just go home and change it, man, if you can't play it. And then he'd be like, no, I'm gonna play it. And then he would just work it out and just rip it, you know? And uh-huh. So if you look at the beginning to You Go to My Head, that stuff up there is just like impossible. If you look at, man, Starting Now, some people thought I like shifted it all up an octave. It's not, man. It's
really?
Like he's playing okay. Like trumpet range on the tenor trombone. And it has this amazing, really cool sound. And also, he kind of retired a horn. He had this vintage King Silver Sonic. He had played so much his like natural oils and acids in his hand just like ate through the slide. I had him bring him for that album. I don't even know if he's played it since, really. It's like my favorite horn that he sounds good, which is weird because like people say that to me on certain horns that I play, and they're, you know, and I get all like mad about it. The way the trombones sound in that register, there's something really amazing about it, the way it blossoms and all of that stuff. And yeah, like I know the people. Even now when I'm hiring or I'm calling people to do certain things, I'm working on a flugelbone bass trumpet brass band album called Bone Apple Tea, and I just know who's got the chops to do this. I know, I mean, just because you're playing third or fourth doesn't mean that you're like not a good. I know who has like the deep chops to be able to blend with me. I'm usually on the bottom because that's like my specialty and all of that stuff. And you know, you think about the balance of all the people, and that's not new. You know, Duke Ellington wrote for the people he hired. He wrote to everyone's strengths, and that's why he was such a great composer. And that's why a lot of his music is just inimitable, you know?
Is there kind of an equivalent of the Stradivarius violins in kind of the brass world?
It's really interesting. There's a, what is it? The Reynolds Contempora, which is, you know, some people want to say it's, apparently there's this old bass trombone, which was a double valve bass trombone that was the first double valve bass trombone. I can't think of the model number, but they want to say that the Reynolds Contempora is the first double valve modern bass trombone. You know, like if I got a chance, or like the Akon 72H from a certain era, which was this guy, George Roberts, the horn that he used, and it has a certain sound to it. So yes and no. I like, you know, Stradivarius, like technically they get better with age. I'm not like the whole thing about brass instruments is they can get better with age, because you know the more you play the instrument, the more it kind of settles into itself and into that person.
Gotcha.
Some people just want something brand spanking new. You know, some people like older horns, and it's just like anything. Like old horn, you kind of have to tell it what to do, but you get to tell it what to do. A new horn is going to be efficient, and some people feel like that efficiency allows you to get closer to your sound. So it just depends on who you are.
What brought you into playing the bass trombone? Like, what were you like, yes, this is the instrument for me?
It's so interesting. My high school band director, he heard me play trombone, 8th grade. I auditioned for him. And he right off was like, you're going to play bass trombone. So he gave me the bass trombone next year in high school. And, you know, that's just what I played. And it became part of my voice. And I started improvising, and then I went to college and played, and it just was what I did. And you know, I remember in undergrad for a long time I was just like the only cat, and I think I really liked being like, you know, the only cat, like kind of top dog on this instrument or whatever. I liked the uniqueness of having an instrument that, like, being able to like be a voice on an instrument that not that many people have like championed or whatever in that way, in a non-utilitarian sense.
Yeah, because it's not like, it doesn't sound like a euphonium. It doesn't sound like a baritone. It doesn't sound like a tuba. I mean, it's like that one. There's a few brass instruments that are within that range, but nothing really has that kind of sound. And that's you in this song doing the bass kind of solo, so to speak.
Yeah.
I think that's like in the third section or whatever, and just that wah, you know, kind of sound to it. Yeah, very rich, but also like kind of throaty and gutsy. Like, it has such a unique voice in a way, and it it stands out, you know. But that's cool.
Yeah,
I love it.
Thank you. I appreciate that. Well, you know, it's one of those things I was telling someone. They're like, why though? I'm like, hey, you know, like, you don't get to choose, you know. I mean, I guess I could have chosen something else, but like, if you are something not typical that does something, that wants to do something that's not typical for what you are, you don't have any choice but to be who you are.
Yeah.
That's like me kind of beating around the bush about it.
Yeah,
but you know what I'm trying to say?
Yeah.
It's just like,
do you see it as like, this instrument is you? Like,
yeah,
it's
that's
very
how
much
I say it.
Your
this
personality
is the one that
right?
I play.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, this is the one that I play. And so like, and I like, I happen to be want to be expressive also.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
I want to be an artist. And so I could switch instruments, but then that would take me back like 20 years. And you know, I mean, maybe not. I have been playing a lot of tuba recently since moving to New York, like about 2 years now, which is crazy to think about. It's been that long, which isn't a short time, but still, I mean, which isn't a long time, but still. In that time, like I basically like taught myself how to play at a professional level. Then I went on tour with this Lucky Chops band, and now there's a semi-viral video out of me like playing a solo that people are like copying and stuff. You know what I mean? And so, nice. So yeah, like there's a voice there too, you know? You know, I definitely chalk that up to being able to do all of that on the bass trombone and really understand how to move and groove in that register.
COVID-19 got you down? You looking for some music? Some video games? Well, Exile Main Street still has all the things you need. New and used LPs, CDs, and video games. Exile Main Street still has something for any music enthusiast and old school gaming devotee. Exile Main Street is taking orders, making deliveries, and pickups by appointment. They can find just about any music or video game you need. Check out their website, ExileMainStreet.com, for links to their Discogs page for new additions. You can also contact them via Facebook Messenger to see what they can find for you. They can also be reached on Instagram, Twitter, email, or phone at 217-398-MAIN. That's 217-398-6246. So, you were in the Champaign-Urbana music scene. Let's talk about the Champaign-Urbana music scene for a while.
Okay, yeah, that's what I was waiting for that one.
Yeah, so do you have a particular like favorite venue that you played at, or?
That's a really tough one, you know, because I have a lot of really great experiences with all the stuff, you know. That's really, I mean, the Iron Post, it has to be like the top one. But, you know, like, for one, it was fun, like, cut my teeth on some jazz standards, and it was, you know, a lot of great, like, just great experiences there, and just really digging into all of that stuff. You know, they also let me play a lot of my original music there, and, you know, and there were times where there were lots of people coming out to, like, check out the Pressure Fit stuff. It meant a lot that they were open to that, and, like, and willing and wanting more of that. You know, that's kind of the low-hanging fruit for a jazz musician to say that about Urbana-Champaign, though. You know?
Right, right.
The High Dive was cool.
There were some good shows at the High Dive, for sure, and I think for the most part, I went to the High Dive, you know, for like Pygmalion and some of the...
Yeah, this one's Pygmalion and Cover-Ups. Those were the...
Yeah.
But Cover-Ups were really cool because I like got to meet a lot of different musicians. They wanted horns, you know? And so like I did arrangements for you know, I'm drawn blank. Was it We the Animals? Is that one of them?
Yeah, yeah.
And then what's the guitar player? He's now like a city councilman. Mike Ingram.
Yeah.
Doing some stuff with him, with the Dirty Feathers. Definitely with Elsinore. I did a bunch of those with Elsinore. The thing about it is like jazz school was fun for me, but the town that I came from, like, you know, it was about creativity. Like we, you know, even as horn players, we saw ourselves as indie rock musician. You know, I'm on a Megaphone album and I got a chance to play with Justin Vernon and Bon Iver and and guys from The National and all of these, you know, all of these guys, just different sensibilities and different value systems as far as like what music could be and like who we're playing for and why we're playing it, you know, which is not, I'm not trying to poo-poo jazz or like power jazz or any of that stuff. That stuff is killing. You know what I mean? I love it. And definitely like want to be a part of it. I always feel super guilty when I'm not able to hang on some crazy bebop tune or whatever. Mm. And like, you know, like, okay, whatever. I mean, High Dive is in there. I mean, Cowboy Monkey, I never had any personal experiences at Cowboy Monkey. I've always played in other people's groups at Cowboy Monkey. Definitely had experiences going to see certain bands there. So Cowboy Monkey is up there. I'm basically, I guess I'm just naming all the ones in here.
Yeah.
I guess Iron Post might be the top one, but the other ones are just important, you know?
Yeah. Now you've been in New York for 2 years and you've also been with, well, national acts that have probably toured around. How do you feel it compares to like the Champaign Urbana music scene?
Man, how does it compare? I mean, the jazz scene in Urbana-Champaign is pretty amazing. You know what I mean? And I can't compare it to New York, you know? I mean, there are things that it does have that New York doesn't. Urbana-Champaign does have a great jazz scene. And I guess you could compare it to New York in the sense that there's some people who've been there and all different types of facets of jazz that play at the Iron Post regularly. Mm. One thing that I struggle with in New York, and I, you know, I've only been here for two, I've only seen like a percentage of the music scene at large here. You know what I mean? It's that big. Even brass musicians, jazz musicians, there's so many that I meet that I just never even knew about. And I'm like, wow, I didn't, you're amazing. And I didn't know you existed. You know, I think it's hard to find bands in New York just because unless you have some type of other income that doesn't take up all your time, it's impossible. Logistics, it's just impossible to do anything. You know what I mean? And most people who are making music for a living here, they have to worry about the bottom line. Even if you are a band on your way to like getting to the point to where you don't have to like do the hustle and you can just go on tour and then come back home and chill, you have to do the hustle. You know, all the bands I know who are doing that, like they did the hustle, weddings,
right,
corporate events and all of this stuff. And they've also gone through a lot of different personnel changes on the way there. And that's the thing. It's like personnel are so transient in New York because everybody has to think about their bottom line and has to think about like what is going to be the best thing for them coming up next. And so say someone's there for a while, they might have a better gig on their radar where they don't have to like schlep so hard in order to make their living. Then next thing you know, they're doing this other thing, you know? That's the cool thing about Urbana-Champaign is the whole idea of bands and the whole idea of an identity. And like, I remember seeing a Dirty Feathers show at a house. It was just the nastiest, amazing. Like you can't pretend that. Just like the groove was so saggy and like, yo, it was so killing. It was just so good. And these guys grew up together and they like, they know each other, blah, blah, blah. They remember this person's first girlfriend. They remember when that person got too drunk and did something embarrassing. They remember when this other person, like, you know, achieved a certain dream. Like, you know, you can, all of that stuff, like, you know, emanates, that collective experience just emanates from that. And so they don't have to be playing anything crazy or fast or high or loud or complex or like whatever. Just the profundity of their like a collective existence is just good enough coming through the music, you know? And that's something in my experience, and I know I'm wrong, but it's hard to find that everywhere.
I feel like I'm preaching to the choir, but I do find that Champaign Urbana manages to be this very unique community that tends to be up for anything and everything kind of sound and music. And I just can't say enough about how much I just love this community. I wonder, do you miss the Champaign Urbana music scene? Or?
Oh, yeah. There's a certain side of that. It's so funny. Ever since this quarantine, I've been getting back into that. I moved here and then it was just everyone was trying me out, like, you know, giving me chances. It was great. Met a lot of people, did a lot of cool things. But, you know, over time, you start to like develop your home team, you know? And so, you know, I've been putting together the Pressure Fit Band has been really awesome, and like really collecting a specific amount of people, the same people, like a reoccurring, and developing a community in that way. That has been pretty cool to finally get to a point where like now we can like start to create something that's not just, you know, flash, like quick, like episodic type thing. So yeah, like I do miss not having to chase a dollar just to be able to have enough space in my life to be able to create something new that may or may not be commercially viable. I want to be able to create music that is personal. I want it to be commercially viable, but I don't want to, while I'm creating it, I don't want to have to worry about whether it's commercially viable or not. Places like Richmond and all of these places, like that's what they kind of have over in New York. Cheap rent. This gig's not going to pay you much anyways. We're here to like enjoy ourselves and be part of this thing. And we're going to play from our hearts. That's just what it is. Here it goes. You know what I mean? You can't do that here, man.
Yeah.
You're not even going to get a gig. You can't even get, or you're going to get a gig where it's going to turn out that you like ended up paying to play.
Oh my gosh. Or,
like, you know, and that they exist. Those places exist where like at the end of the night, well, there weren't enough people in here. Either you're getting zero or like, hey man, you got to pay the blah, blah, blah. Like they'll take however much off the top before you even get yours. Jeez. You know what I mean? Just for fees and stuff. You know what I mean? And that's what I'm saying. But for some people that works, like if you have like some type of expendable income, you can afford that, then you can do that a bunch until your tables turn, until your tide turns, you know? That's the thing. It's just the bottom line in economics and capitalism and everything like is all just in the cauldron of the arts in this city. But I mean, that's just what it is at large in the world. Like if you want to go somewhere and you want, you know, at some point you're going to get to that point. It's just what it is.
I don't know. Is there any band that you know of or knew of in the Champaign Urbana music scene that like really still captures your fancy or like you really enjoy listening to, or you say, gosh, I really can't wait to hear something from them new and,
well,
you know,
I mean, there's Elsinore. There's, you know, I still keep up with James a lot. Like he's actually, he's co-mixing an album that I'm working on. The Emily Blue stuff, she's moved to Chicago. So technically she's Chicago. Same thing with Melvin Knight. He was a Pressure Fit guy for a while. He's moved to Chicago, which I'm happy. He seems like he's thriving there. You know, a lot of that community has kind of moved on. And so, I mean, that's the other side of Urbana-Champaign is it's a transient community. Man, I loved playing with Rebecca Rigo. We learned so much from each other. And those were really good days being able to figure out how to play behind a highly sensitive vocalist in that way. She's moved too. You know what I mean?
Oh, yeah.
A lot of people have moved.
It's been a pleasure to see people that in some ways kind of cut their teeth on the Champaign Urbana music scene and then kind of go somewhere else and like take what they've learned and like the contacts that they've made and people that they've met and like turned it into something really amazing. I mean, you're in New York, but you're still corresponding with James Streichler and you're even working on projects together. And it's cool. I love that. Yeah, I love that. Like the influences is kind of far reaching, like, you know.
I know people usually say the yard in a different way, you know what I mean, but it's kind of, it's the yard, you know what I mean. It's I think about growing up and with me and my cousins and the kids in the neighborhood, we used to just go like play in the woods or like or just like whatever, like we just went outside and played and did random stuff and thought of stuff, and there were always like different like roles that everybody played, and like the leader or like the blah 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 or like, you know, whatever. You know, and then just thinking about how real life is like a macrocosm of that. CU was definitely that, you know, it's just everybody, there's nothing to lose, you know, here, like we'll play a free gig. It's just what it is. We want to make some money, but even the amount of money when it felt like we were making some money, like in the grand scheme of things, wasn't that much money.
Right.
You know what I mean? Like, but everybody was just trying stuff, you know, and connecting and doing all of this stuff. And then you had a willing audience of fans, like non-musician fans and colleagues alike that were there rooting you on even when you were sucking, you know what I mean? Just sucking, just not doing good.
Yeah.
But then you try it out and then next thing you know, you have a thing, you know?
Yeah.
And it's cool. It's really cool.
Even in the midst of the current shelter-in-place order, the Jubilee Cafe is continuing to serve packaged home-cooked meals free to all every Monday evening. 5 to 6:30 p.m. Meals are available for pickup outside the 6th Street door to the Community United Church of Christ in Champaign, Illinois, 805 South 6th Street in Champaign. Jubilee Cafe's mission remains the same. Feed hungry people by cooking healthy and delicious meals. We are open to anyone who cares to receive a meal. For information on the meal or how to volunteer, go to the Jubilee Cafe CUCC Facebook page or email us at jubilee.cafe@community-ucc.org. Reginald, what is your favorite non-musical thing?
My favorite non-musical thing is my wife. She pulls me into all the non-music. That's the only superpower in the world that can pull me out of the musical days. Otherwise, I think I would just be like a person in rags just trying to make music like 24/7.
How did you meet your wife?
Oh, met in Richmond, Virginia. She was roommates with one of my best friends from there. And I think she had seen me play at an OBS show, which is kind of interesting that it still ties in the music. But
yeah, well, you know, hey, but yeah. You met. How was the first date? Do you remember your first date? Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, it was great. It was really good. Like, I think, you know, it was refreshing to, you know, spend time with someone where like the musical common ground wasn't quite there. And so like I had to really think about other things to connect with, you know, which is awesome and really fulfilling, you know?
Awesome. Yeah. So how long have you been married?
We've been together for about 4 or 5 years now, and awesome. We've been married for coming up on a year.
And how was the proposal done? I'm just,
oh, it could be Urbana-Champaign.
Awesome.
And I was leaving to go to do a residency. Like I was going to fly out that morning and we were going to meet up and go to the Grand Canyon afterwards, which was really cool. I was going to do it there, but then I didn't want to do it there. I just wanted to get it over with. So I used this letter board that we had, like one of those hipstery ones.
Uh-huh.
I wrote like "marry me?" question mark on there. And then I like woke her up and had her come out and like she read the letter board and I gave her the ring. And you know, it was cool.
Awesome.
We have a video too.
Oh, really?
Look at the video. The video is somewhere.
Awesome. You know, I feel like if I tried to do that as a proposal, it would be like I'd put it up on the letterboard and they would get up and not be wearing their glasses or something and couldn't read it. And I'd be like, hey, can you just look over at the board over there?
I mean, that kind of was the scene, though. That definitely was the scene. You know what I mean? So
yeah.
It wasn't like a perfect like thing, but whatever, you know?
Yeah, well, usually like the most imperfect things that we do on a romantic level, I feel like make really great stories in the future, right?
So, oh, yeah, it's so true. It's so true.
Awesome. Reginald, thank you for taking the time to talk with me and tell me all about your album Prototype and your song Hoodie and music theory and the Champaign Urbana music scene, and like my mind is spinning and I'm super excited to have met you this way and talk to you, and I really look forward to hearing this new album that you're working on, and I just really appreciate you taking the time. Thank you so much.
Dude, thank you, man. I mean, especially with in these times, as everyone says now, it's nice to be able to connect with people and, you know, get the word out there. And then it's also nice to take the time to hash out some of these things just to like to be grateful. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's especially we live in Brooklyn. I mean, we've been walking around a little bit more, but it's still pretty confining. And so it's easy to just get dark. And so taking the time to like to be appreciated, which I appreciate you appreciating me. And then also like, you know, thinking about all of the good things, you know, in the past and now and in the future is really helpful. Thank you for listening to Champaign Is Also a Band podcast. This is Reginald Chapman reminding you, great music is out there. Go find it where you live.
You almost have an NPR voice. It's so good.